Hello everyone. Sorry about the audio. I forgot to unmute myself, but thank you again for continuing on this journey with us with our theme, How Can We Sing in a Strange Land? It was really a wonderful opportunity to hear the commentary, the scholarship by Dr. Jimmy Abington. He's a great friend and colleague and mentor. I consider him in many ways, and I hope that you were able to really make a strong connection between the message in the African American spiritual and in gospel music, and how those messages have enabled a people to not just survive, but to persevere and to fortify themselves with the inspiration needed in order to make it through challenging times, whether those challenging times were that of slavery. The challenging times of discrimination that continued through the civil rights movement, and perhaps even some of the challenging times of marginalization, injustice, and discrimination that continue to this day. I'd like to start by having you listen to an instrumental version of Deep River. We heard the vocal version by Miriam Anderson. Listen to this instrumental version, and the reason I want you to hear it is because it was recently recorded by the Chineke Ensemble in England, and I think that it's very relevant in terms of the function of this piece of music in today's climate. So let's go to our PowerPoint and listen to the. So we'll go to the next slide. And we will listen to this ensemble. So just as we experienced the wonderful sounds of Marian Anderson singing Deep River, we now hear an instrumental version. And this instrumental version really speaks to the present day challenges that we continue to face. And this ensemble decided to perform this piece in tribute to George Floyd and to Breonna Taylor and so many others who have lost their lives over the past year as a result of racial discrimination and injustice. What I want to do now is define the term social justice. And so if we can pull the next slide. And so I'm going to have to turn to the side here so that I can see the words. But social justice is defined as promoting a just society by challenging injustice and valuing diversity. It exists when all people share common humanity and therefore have a right to equitable treatment, support for their human rights, and a fair allocation of community resources. In conditions of social justice, people are not to be discriminated against, nor their welfare and well-being constrained or prejudiced on the basis of gender, sexuality, religion, political affiliations, age, race, belief, disability, location, social class, socioeconomic circumstances, or other characteristic or background or group membership. So this is a very broad and all-encompassing definition of social justice, and it begins to help us to understand in many ways, perhaps, how we can connect music to these principles of social justice. Let's go to the next slide. The pillars of social justice are diversity, equity, and inclusion. Sometimes you hear the word access also in this definition. And access can sometimes be connected to equity. So for today, we're going to look at the principles of diversity, equity, and inclusion. Next slide. So diversity is all about differences. It's about what makes us different. And as part of any sort of call to social justice, we have to begin to acknowledge how we are different, even though we are also at the same time perhaps trying to advocate for our common humanity. Equity is this idea that people are given what they need to not just survive, but to thrive in society. And finally, inclusion is this idea that our voice matters, and that who we are is so important, and what we're about has to be a part of that equation. Next slide. Different people have different needs, and that's this idea of diversity and equity working together, hand in hand. It's kind of like the intersection of both diversity and equity. Diversity and inclusion working together is this notion that our differences not only matter, but in some ways it makes us better. We're able to learn more, we're able to do more, and we're able to accomplish more by the diversity of talents and the unique abilities that we can bring to a situation and collectively work toward a common purpose. And this idea of the quality of life of all citizens matters is the intersection of both inclusion and equity. Next slide. So, African American spirituals and social justice. What is the connection between the two? We heard wonderful commentary from Dr. Abington about how this is possible. And I'd like to go further a little bit just by citing a book entitled Somebody's Calling My Name, Black Sacred Music and Social Change by the late Dr. Wyatt T. Walker. And in that particular book, which was written a number of years ago, back in 1979, he actually helps us to clearly understand in these quotes here how it is that African Americans, as they were creating these spirituals, were using them as a tool to persevere, using them as a tool to, in very sort of covert ways, speak out against the injustices of slavery and oppression. They were also using these spirituals as a tool to help them to understand how to live better in community. So that's what Wyatt T. Walker has to offer us, and I certainly hope that at some point you will consider his book. Let's go to the next slide. The American Spiritual Ensemble gives us a glimpse of how the African American spiritual evolved and particularly played a role during times of slavery and during the period of the Civil Rights Movement. So let us watch this very short clip from the American Spiritual Ensemble, a professional choral group here in the United States.
Spirituals come from deep inside. It's moans, it's groans, it's feelings, it's passion. I don't think we'll ever really know where it came from, but we know it came out of pain.
One of the reasons it's such a challenge to really know these songs is because the very nature of them was secret. One could lose his or her life for communicating the coded messages that these songs had.
Quite often masters tolerated this music because it did have this calming and soothing and peaceful nature about it. It was beautiful stuff. Hold my
hand, Lord. The modern day civil rights movement has its roots in the deep, deep South. And so as the civil rights movement kicked off, the spirituals were front and center and absolutely perfect for the moment.
I had noticed a trend toward gospel music, praise music, and music that was more of a pop idiom, and the traditional, the classical spirituals were really being lost. And so I decided to form this group to teach the music of the cotton fields, the music of the slaves. These melodies affect people in very unusual ways. It's something about the melodies that are haunting, that are lyric, that are overwhelming just in their own right.
So I hope that you enjoyed that clip that really gives us a deeper understanding of how African American spirituals in particular played such a prominent role in helping to move forward various social justice causes. Let's go to the next slide. And this slide tells us about how we can use choral music in general to teach principles of social justice. Levy and Bird state that song lyrics often include ideas related to social justice, such as accepting others, challenging discrimination, examining privilege, and rejecting violence. With reference to the dominance of the Western choral canon, Norwood and others say that only through radical integration of non-white traditions in our choral curricula will we be able to dismantle our field's current upholding of systemic racial hierarchy and oppression. Speaking as someone who works in the classical music field and was trained in it, we still continue to struggle within classical choral music and even classical instrumental music to make sure that there is equity in terms of how we program music that is non-Western. And even how we study music that is non-Western. So I think that we still have a long ways to go, and the inclusion of non-Western musics into our curricula, for those of you who are in education, continues to be a social justice issue in and of itself. And finally, Deborah Bradley asserts that for those of us as choral music educators, we wield a very powerful tool. Choral music has the ability to deliver social messages in a way unlike any other discipline. And through the act of singing, we not only embody the music, but also the message of the song. And this embodiment can occur with little or no conscious effort, yet the performative impact may be lasting or even permanent. Let's go to the next slide. So how do social justice lyrics reveal themselves and play themselves out in spirituals in particular? Some African American spirituals embody the themes of challenging oppression and challenging injustice. Some spirituals speak of perseverance and moments of marginalization. Some spirituals instruct the slaves to reject violence. Some spirituals champion the concepts of inclusion, equity, and access. Next slide. So here are just three examples of spirituals that challenge oppression and injustice. Go Down Moses, which I think many of us have heard, Let My People Go. Old Freedom, which says, "Old freedom over me. Before I'll be a slave, I'll be resting in my grave and go home to my Lord and be free." And then this third example, Great Day. Notice here on the right side of the screen, the lyrics. Great day, the righteous marching, great day, God's going to build up Zion's walls. Chariot rode in the mountaintop. My God spoke and the chariot did stop. This is the day of Jubilee. The Lord has set his people free. We want no cowards in our band as we go marching through the land. I'll take my breastplate, sword, and shield and march out boldly in the field. So you can see metaphorically here, the slaves were constructing these melodies and these lyrics that really talked about going to battle against oppression, against the things that were hindering their progress. And so we see the lyrics here talking about not having any cowards in our band, but marching through the land. So we see the elements of protest, of marching, peaceful protest in this spiritual. And then we see, I'll take my breastplate, sword, and shield, and march out boldly in the field, that we will march out and we will stand for justice and we will stand for what is right. Let's go to the next slide and hear an example of this spiritual being sung by Jesse Norman and Kathleen Battle. It hardly gets any better than that. That's just a classic performance by the late Jesse Norman and Kathleen Battle. Let's jump to the next slide. And let's look, now that we've looked at spirituals that challenge oppression and injustice, there are also spirituals that speak of perseverance in moments of marginalization. One is Walk Together Children. Walk together, children, don't you get weary. Walk together, children, don't you get weary. There's a great camp meeting in the Promised Land. So we can hear in the lyrics about not giving up. And another spiritual that falls into this same category as far as social justice is concerned is Keep Your Hand on the Plow. Look at the lyrics. Paul and Silas locked in jail didn't have no one to get their bail. Keep your hand on the plow, hold on. Mary wore three links of chain. Every link was in my Jesus' name. Keep your hand on the plow, hold on. The refrain, hold on, hold on. Keep your hand on the plow, hold on. This would be considered a New Testament spiritual, and this was so common with African American spirituals where they were able to encode into the text these biblical narratives and these stories that they greatly related to. And they believed that if God could do these wonderful, amazing things for these biblical figures, then surely through their faith, the slaves believed that God could do these things for them. And so it was not unusual that a slave would probably be tilling the soil, maybe even holding on to a plow while singing this particular piece. So let's listen to a very short 1 minute clip of Chanticleer out in San Francisco sing the Joseph Jennings arrangement of Keep Your Hand on the Plow.
Keep your hand on the plow, hold on, hold on.
Silas locked in jail, didn't have no one to go to bail. Keep your hand on the plow, hold on,
hold on.
Mary wore three links of chain, every link was in my Jesus' name. Keep your hand on the plow, hold on,
hold on.
Okay, we'll jump to the next slide, in which we profile spirituals that give us specific instructions on how to reject violence. Take, for example, a very common spiritual, Down by the Riverside, whose words say, gonna lay down my burden down by the riverside, I ain't gonna study war no more. So there were elements of peaceful resistance in these spirituals. And this spiritual in particular, certainly beyond slavery, post-emancipation, made its way into the repertoire during the civil rights movement. Another one, I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river in my soul. The spiritual we're going to listen to shortly is entitled Let Me Fly. And I would encourage those of you who have been able to go to the JanFest website and pull up the score to sing right along. This spiritual has very explicit lyrics in the third verse in particular about rejecting violence, where it says, meet that hypocrite on the street. First thing he'll do is show his teeth. Next thing he'll do is tell a lie. And the best thing to do is pass him by. I use this spiritual very often with children and youth choirs to instruct them not only about the importance of the spiritual and its history, but about how important these words are and can be applicable to their own lives when it comes to being a good citizen and rejecting violence. So let's listen to the South Carolina Elementary All-State Choir sing Let Me Fly, and I encourage you to sing right along. Your SATB version will fit just perfectly with the two-part version that they're singing. Here we go, Let Me Fly.
Oh, let me fly.
I hope you enjoyed singing along to that arrangement of Let Me Fly. Let's jump to the next slide. So there are also spirituals that champion this idea of inclusion, equity, and access. And if you recall, this harkens back to our early discussion about equity, access, and inclusion being really some of the foundational pillars of social justice. Some of those spirituals that fall into this category are The Gospel Train, Did My Lord Deliver Daniel, I've Got Shoes, and You've Got a Right. Specifically, The Gospel Train is one that I just absolutely love in order to, as an example, to teach about inclusion, equity, and access. The first verse says, the gospel train's a-coming, I hear it just as hand, I hear the car wheels moving and rumbling through the land. And of course, we know that the train was often used as a reference to signify the Underground Railroad and the perhaps pending escape of a slave. And then the chorus says, get on board, little children, get on board. There's room for many a more. So there's this idea of inclusion, that there's always room for more. The fare is cheap and all can go. The rich and poor are there. No second class aboard this train, no difference in the fare. I don't know how much more explicit you can be when it comes to talking about inclusion, equity, and access when looking at this particular verse. The fare is cheap, all can go, there's access there. The rich and poor are there, meaning that's equity, everybody is the same. No second class aboard this train, no difference in the fare. Now let's listen to the Aeolians at Oakwood University, conducted by Dr. Jason Max Ferdinand. This is a wonderful arrangement of The Gospel Train. I hope you enjoyed that wonderful arrangement. So let me just sort of summarize before I go on to talk about other African-American music not being spirituals. I wanted to let you know that spirituals are historical artifacts, and they teach us about the past, they allow us to reflect upon the present, and they give us an opportunity to shape the direction of our future. Spirituals are not just about the African-American experience, they're also about the human experience. While these songs embody what I call culturally specific elements, such as slavery and the musical sounds that are part of the African continent, these songs also reflect the humanly universal themes of suffering, loss, injustice, marginalization, perseverance, faith, hope, and even joy. This is why spirituals can and should be performed by anyone of any background, not just African Americans. many people often ask me, well, why do we need to sing spirituals in the present day when this music is clearly about the past? Well, just as Dr. Abington said, you know, I believe that spirituals have relevant messages and lessons to teach all of us. Not only can we learn about what was a very dark time in our nation's history through this music, but we can hopefully learn how to treat one another with dignity and respect, even if our backgrounds and our worldviews are different. This body of repertoire teaches us how music can be used as a tool to protest, persevere, and achieve inner peace. When teaching this music to young people in particular, I often ask them to think about the times in which they have used music to help them through a crisis situation. The African American spiritual served the very same purpose. Let's move to the next slide and talk about the artist citizen, because this is a philosophy that comes from David Elliott, a very well-known music education philosopher, that really sort of shapes my work moving forward with not just African-American spirituals, but music that expresses the African-American experience. So in developing the artist citizen, it's this idea that music educators in particular must prepare their students to put their music to work for the betterment of other people's lives and social well-being. Helping students to conceive and practice music making as ethical action for social justice, and to aim to infuse school music with an ethic of care for oneself and the health of our social communities. I truly believe that we have the power as music educators to not just let the music that we teach and that we celebrate serve the function of existing for the sake of art, but that we can really put that music to work and get out of the music the message and the history and the meaning that will enable us to apply that to our current lives, and maybe even apply that music to our societal surroundings. So let's go to the next slide, and I'll give you an example of how I hope that I've been able to do that in my own work. I have been studying the works of Paul Laurence Dunbar, Gwendolyn Brooks, Langston Hughes, James Baldwin, and Maya Angelou, just to name a few African-American poets, for much of my life. And as I have moved forward in my career as a composer and an arranger, I have found that it is not enough for me as an African-American, classically trained, gospel trained musician to just put the music out there, but that I have a responsibility to teach others about the lives of these poets, to teach them about the messages that these poets were trying to convey in their writing, and to perhaps even amplify the messages of these poets in my compositions as I try to set these very important words to music. So this chart just sort of gives you a sense of where I've gone in my own work. I have to date, I think, employed 3 texts by Paul Laurence Dunbar. I think it's about 8 or so of Langston Hughes. Actually, I think it's more than that. Maybe it's about 9 or 10 now. Gwendolyn Brooks, James Baldwin. I'm still working on copyright permissions with both Baldwin and Brooks Estates. And then Maya Angelou, I've been working with her agent, even though she's passed away. And I'm actually setting my 3rd piece of hers to music. So let's jump ahead to a Paul Laurence Dunbar, to the next slide. And this slide outlines the poem Justice by Paul Laurence Dunbar. And it says, enthroned upon the mighty truth within the confines of the laws, true justice seeth not the man, but only hears his cause. Second stanza, unconscious of his creed or race, she, being justice, cannot see but only ways, for justice with unbandaged eyes would be oppression in disguise. This particular poem has become an anthem for me. I think I may have set it to music about 10 years ago, and it continues to be one that that I try to incorporate into my teaching. Most recently, the Phoenix Boys Choir, recorded this piece, and I would encourage you to sing along using your score from the JanFest webpage, and I hope that you enjoy this performance of Justice, and I hope that you enjoy singing along with the recording. Here we go, Justice.
Near the end of this song, we're going to add claps on measure 45 to 48, plus the repeat. Get ready.
Enjoyed singing along with that performance by the Phoenix Boys Choir. Next slide, please. We're going to sort of shift right into some personal reflections, and I just want to just talk for a few moments about my own life growing up as a young kid who was exposed to both classical music and who was exposed to gospel music and to African American spirituals. Thank you, Julie Dana, for the shout out there. I really believe that that from the time I was a little kid that I was really called and put on this earth to do what it is I'm doing to this day, and I'm just so grateful that I had a family, a non-musical family at that, and a community of people, including my music teachers, who surrounded me with the opportunities and the experiences that I needed in order to move forward with my work. I started taking piano lessons formally when I was 9 years old, and I was learning. I had two teachers at that time. I had my choral teacher, who was also teaching me gospel music, and she was my school music teacher as well as my church choir music teacher, so I had a lot of experiences with her. And I also had a piano teacher who was good friends with my choral teacher, And together they wanted the best for me. They wanted me to be able to play everything that I could see on the written page in front of me, and also be able to play what was not on that written page by using my ear, by using my intellect, by using my imagination, and even my ability to imitate what I would hear other people play, on piano in churches in particular. So as I grew up through my teenage years, I was listening to and singing classical music. I was singing gospel music. I was listening to, jazz. I was listening to rhythm and blues. I was listening to folk music. I was listening to country western music. I was listening to every kind of music possible. And particularly as I would leave my Sunday morning Catholic church services under the direction of my church choir director, she would, and we would sing everything from chant to gospel in those services. She would take me to the Baptist and to the Pentecostal churches. I'm sure very similar to what Dr. Abington was talking about when he talked about the history of gospel music. And I was made to just sit behind or next to whoever the pianist or the Hammond B3 organist was, and I would just have to listen to those players and watch them for hours. And I was not allowed to write anything down until I could go home. And I could write the music down. I would have to replicate this music in some of my lessons. And it was really powerful. I had no idea what kind of training I was getting. Now, my classical music teacher did not allow me to play any gospel in her piano studio. It was just the classics. It was all the scales and the arpeggios and the chords and the cadences. It was all of the Hannon studies. It was all of the Czerny etudes. It was the Bach preludes and fugues. It was the Beethoven and Mozart and Haydn sonatas. It was the Chopin mazurkas and the polonaises, and the Brahms intermezzi. And I enjoyed both of those worlds. And I never saw myself as being one or the other, but really a combination of both. And I think what that experience did for me, which is what I hope to continue to do for my students and singers that I come into contact with, is to broaden their worldview, is to help them to understand themselves a little bit better and understand others through the musical experiences that they have, the opportunity to explore not only their own culture and background, but explore the culture and the backgrounds of others. Because I believe that it is only through this kind of exposure and expansion of one's worldview that we can use music in a very powerful way to help us to understand and to engage differences and to engage the diversity that exists around us. So I hope that as we continue with our work, that we will not just think about music, particularly African-American music, choral music, as an opportunity to just sing fun pieces or to sing pieces that connect to a history, that we think more deeply than that. This is not just, spiritual is not just a fun piece that you throw at the end of a concert, but that it is really an opportunity to understand the context and the history of a people of years ago, and relate that history and the lessons of that music to our present day, so that the hope is that we can chart a brighter and a better future for everyone involved. So I will stop there in terms of my reflections, but I will ask that my wonderful producers jump to the last slide, which is the ML. Oh, that's my references. That's because, when I do these presentations, I have to show myself approved, I guess, with the references. So let's jump to the next slide that has the Martin Luther King and how appropriate we are in this Martin Luther King holiday weekend. And one of my favorite quotes, of course, as it relates to justice, is his saying, "Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere." So that is my last slide. I thank you so much for this opportunity. I wanted to leave some time for questions that you might have before we venture into our last segment. So if there are any questions that you might have or reflections that you care to offer, I'm happy to engage with you for just a few minutes.
Hi, Rollo.
Hi, Brad.
Hi. I've been added in because I wanted to start with a question for you and give other people a chance to think of questions of their own. I believe, and I think you would agree with me, that really fine music making comes from the spirit of the person. You know, we watch Yo-Yo Ma play the cello, and of course he can play anything or do anything on that instrument, but it's the spirit of Yo-Yo Ma that that we respond to. And this is really, frankly, what I'm seeing with you. You are such a tremendous spirit, a man of great intellect and knowledge and skill, but also a person who really wants to make the world a better place. And you've been so gracious in remembering the people that helped you get there. That all being said, and I don't want to put you on the spot in any way that doesn't feel comfortable, I wonder if it's, you know, always been sweetness and light for you, or, I mean, that's not possible for any human. And do you have any times that you could speak to that, that may be particular to your history or your, you know, being an African-American in the classical music world, you know, things of that sort?
Oh, sure. Yeah, I think I have lots of experiences to share. Maybe I'll write a book someday. I should write a book someday. But it had certainly been challenging on so many levels, particularly as an African American, wanting to study and be successful in a world that of classical music where people who look like me have been pushed aside or shut out, or sometimes even told to one's face that, you know, why are you here and what are you doing? And so I've had people ask that. I've had people make assumptions that as an African-American musician, that the only thing that I know about is African-American music. I've been confronted by people who have watched me perform classical music as a conductor and have asked, well, how did you do that? And I think to myself, what do you mean, how did I do that? I practiced, I studied, I went to school, I got these degrees. What do you mean, how did I do that? And so I've had people ask me, how did you do that? And they're shocked that, I guess, that somebody who looks like me has an ability to do a Handel's Messiah or to teach a Brahms Requiem or to do, you know, these amazingly powerful, you know, masterworks. So I feel as though, you know, we still have a long way to go in terms of changing attitudes. There are some attitudes probably that won't ever be changed. And I think we have to be honest and continue to look in our field of choral music broadly and realize that not only that people who look like me have been, you know, sort of, you know, labeled as, you know, not as good as or second rate, but the music that comes from my culture has been labeled as such. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we go to our conferences and our conventions and, you know, we hear, you know, if we hear an African American spiritual performed on the program, it's usually the last song. And what people don't realize is that just by placing it there is one very subtle way of othering the music. It's like saying, okay, we're going to do all the serious music first, and then we're going to do some light, happy, clappy folk. Toe-tapping music that's really not as, you know, as serious.
A little trifle for dessert.
Absolutely. And we also see that this sort of marginalization and othering manifests itself in the amount of attention that we give this music in our textbooks. You would be hard-pressed to find in any college-level choral literature book any African-American music. It's all of the Western European tradition, right? And so the amount of, the lack of attention that we give to musics outside of the Western choral canon tells us a lot about what our field thinks, right? And then what about the amount of attention that sometimes a spiritual gets on the podium relative to the amount of attention we give to, you know, a Bach cantata? You know, we'll dig deeply into, you know, the cantus firmus and the origins of it and how it plays itself out through each movement of the cantata. And then, you know, we'll spend hours studying, you know, performance practice and what instrumentation should we use or not use, or what temperament should we use or not use, and all that sort of thing. You know, we'll spend hours and hours, you know, studying to make sure that we are as authentic as possible. And then when it comes to an African-American spiritual, we won't spend very much time at all learning about what the background is or performance practice, and we'll throw it out there and we'll just, you know, we'll just do it and we're done. So even the amount of attention that we give this music in our classrooms and in our rehearsals seems to be less than that of the attention that we give music of the Western European tradition. So we've got a lot of work to do. And if we're truly going to be an inclusive and equitable field, we've got to make sure that we are not othering music that does not represent, you know, the Western canon, so to speak. So I hope that that's a helpful answer for our conversation, and hopefully for people who are listening.
It's a difficult thing to wrestle with, because of course it's hundreds of years of what we call, you know, dead German white guys that have created the, you know, Beethoven, Bach, Brahms canon that we all admit is great. But you know, by what standard do you say this thing is important or beautiful or what have you? And you know, relativism versus you know, agreed upon standards of excellence. It's a big topic, but I and there are about three more questions that have popped up, but I have one more follow-up. Okay, so in the last year we have seen you know, George Floyd's tragic murder, essentially, Black Lives Matter, the issues that we're facing in the transition of power coming up next week. What do you think? I mean, you're, I guess anybody can look it up. You're 50 years old. You're right kind of in the middle. Do you see it gradually getting better, or is it risen up again to be worse than, say, 10 years ago?
That's a very, very good question. And I don't even know if I have the sort of analytical skills to do justice to answering your question, but I'll certainly give you my perspective. I don't know if things are very different now than they were 10 years ago, or even 5 years ago, or even 1 year ago. Mm-hmm. I think that what has changed is our perspective and our ability to see these things happening. I think that there are I think some people, some groups of people who have always been racist, or who have always been against people of color, they've always been there, but I think that there have been certain circumstances in our discourse that has given permission for this group of people, and maybe to even embolden them to be a little more forward and a little more blatant in their actions. I think that the issues surrounding George Floyd and Breonna Taylor have always been happening. It's just that now we have cell phone cameras, and we have closed circuit TV, and we have security video that has been able to expose these horrible, horrible, horrible acts of injustice to the world. And we have all been sitting at home for the last 10 months, most of us. And we, of course, have been able to be on social media more frequently, to watch television more frequently. And so we're just able to see things, I think, more clearly because of our perspective now. We are able to have this these injustices right before our eyes on a 24-hour news cycle, on a 24/7 social media news feed. And I think that it has awakened a lot of people. I have friends and colleagues who have always understood the challenges, particularly of racial discrimination, even if they're not people of color themselves. But they are now saying to me, oh my gosh, I get it now, or I really see what you've been talking about. And it's not necessarily an opportunity for people of color to say, okay, see, I told you so. This has been going on for the longest time, but you don't believe me, or you've sort of minimized it to think that this is not as prevalent as one may think. But the truth of the matter is, this type of behavior has always been out there, and so many more people are able to see it now, and it's really causing people who feel like they have some sort of social consciousness to speak out and to rise up and to leverage their voice, and in some cases their privilege and power to speak out against these horrible, horrible acts. And that's what we need. We need advocates from all walks of life to speak up and to speak out and to stand up to this awful, awful behavior. And choral music is one tool in which we can use to do that.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm sorry to everyone who asked some wonderful questions. I took a point of privilege there and ate up all the time, but I hope that you have found, certainly I hope that the things I asked Rollo and he answered so eloquently were of interest and relevant to today's discussion.